They say Lot also had sheep, goats and cattle, as well as his own family and servants. So there was not enough pasture of land for the two of them to stay together, because there are too many animals. So quarrels broke out between the men who took care of Abraham's animals and those who took care of God's animals. At that time, the Canaanites and the Perizzites were seen in the land. Then Abraham said to Lot, "We are witnesses, and your men and my men shouldn't be quarreling. So let's separate. Choose any part of the land you want. You go one way, and I will go the other." Lot looked around and saw that the whole Jordan Valley, all the way to Zoar, had plenty of water, like the garden of the Lord, or like the land of Egypt. This was before the Lord had destroyed the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose the whole Jordan Valley for himself and moved away towards the east. That is how the two men parted. Abraham stayed in the land of Canaan, and Lot settled around the cities in the valley and camped near Sodom, whose people were wicked and sinned against the Lord. After Lot had left, the Lord said to Abraham, "From where you are, look carefully in all directions. I'm going to give you and your descendants all the land that you see, and it will be yours forever. I pray that the Lord will bless you forever. I'm going to give you so many descendants that no one will be able to count them all. It will be as easy to count all the steps of God's on earth. Now go and look over the whole land, because I'm going to give it all to you." So Abraham moved his camp and settled near the sacred tree of Mamre at Hebron, and there he built an altar to the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. This month, my dear friends, I want to talk about the power of contentment. The power of contentment. To be content, to be satisfied with what you have. When you are satisfied with what you have, you will not do things wrong. You will do things in the right way. Praise the Lord. Amen. But just before I continue, I start to talk. What we is for the good of the good of all of us. This program is for that is for God. Like I said, God is already doing something for some of us. Amen. During the rosary, our sister was presented. I don't know how I asked you this question, but this one was very good. How do you see yourself as a person? What is your thinking? How do you feel? Are you happy with what you are doing and things around you? Are you? You're happy. You are okay. You are not okay. So you are not happy. See, your life is just like something that is fired, something that is caged, or something that happened during the music for you. During the music, in the physical, she's not okay, she's very alright. But if it's still young, she's like a crippled and sick person. That's the way she is. I don't know how you know yourself in that. But I'm just telling you what happened during the rosary. She is like somebody who she looks like a crippled person in the spiritual. But during the rosary, she was released. It was like a chain that was holding her. When the chain broke, she just took from where she was, exactly what she was wearing, that blue skirt and that top was wearing. I didn't even see her in church, but it was what I thought of there, like nothing of her son. Exactly what she did, she just jumped up from the sea and her hand, the part of the chain was in her right hand that was holding her together. And then she started walking out like somebody that is sick or started learning to walk. It happens during the rosary. So we're going to do something for you as you go on. And God will make you one of them. God will bring you to that beginning and completion of what He has said in your life in the name of Jesus. May that release that God has started to be permanent in your life in the name of Jesus. Sit down, then my hands will come up with you. Amen. Yeah, I think we have about 4 or 5 minutes. I don't know what I mean in this video. So, what I want to say. All right, get back to that. So, coming back to our text, the power of contentment. The power of contentment. Now, Abraham was called by God. If you go to chapter 2, he was called by God, and God said to him, leave your father's house. Leave your father's house. Leave your relatives and leave your country. These are the conditions of God. Now, father's house means everything in the house. It has to be abandoned. Second, he says, relatives. Are you listening? No attachment from that family should follow him. And then he says the word, which means total prayer and submission. So you're going to yield to God. But when Abraham left, he did not abide by all those. First, he took some things. Second, he took his relatives. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. He took Lot because Lot was a relative and he went. So he left the country for another place that God has promised. He left the family, but there was still an attachment. And that was God's loss. Praise God. When God has a plan for you, when God has a plan for you, and you work in your according to your own plan of power and strength, you will get stuck. When you walk like you have all the power and all the authority to move and achieve, like many of us sometimes in our business we want to do power, it's the gift of God. And it is this gift of God that brings us thriving, success. And so Abraham moved, but he was not moving in accordance with the will of God for him. And that's why when God has a plan for your liberation, even if there is a force on your path that will stop that liberation, God will design another strategy to bring about his plan. Praise the Lord. Did you hear me? God's plan for your life must come to pass. It might be delayed, but it must come to do what? Pass. Well, your own desires constitute a hindrance to it. God will bring about a rocking of your boat. And when he rocks your boat, then his own will succeed. And that also happened to Abraham. Now, when Abraham came, when he got to the land, he discovered how the place was, and it was a big dry, so he had to go down to Egypt. His going down to Egypt was a wrong decision. Though God had to forgive him, because you will remember, when he went to Egypt, he lied. And he told them that his wife was his wife's sister. And then, and he said that Pharaoh paid a dowry over the head of Abraham's wife. After that, God was like, he took her into his house. But then God struck. And when God struck, Pharaoh realized what he had done. And Pharaoh said to him, "Why did you lie to me?" Praise the Lord. He said to him, "Why did you lie to me?" And so, when he realized the punishment was going to follow him, he then told to Abraham and said, he packaged his wife back and gave him. The dowry he paid for what I had, he did not collect back. He said, "You are paid." And then he went and packaged extra things, goods, animal, sheep, food, and gave to what? Abraham and said, "Go." Now, Abraham came back from Egypt richer than he went. Likewise, Lot, his brother or his relative, also came back richer. And now, when they came back richer, they came to the land of God wanted them to settle. Problems started between Abraham's headsmen and Lot's what? Headsmen. Praise the Lord. Now, what you said is, the problem that started was ignited by God himself. Why? So that Abraham would separate completely from anything that came from what? Or, as I said, when God's plan for when God plans for you, he will make that plan to do what? Come to pass. Because Lot was considered a hindrance. God wanted a new family with Abraham, a new beginning with Abraham, a new start with Abraham, and there was not to be any kind of interference in God's blessing for him. He said, because if you go back to that, then God said, "See, I will give you all this land. I will bless you." And then God said to him, "You will be a blessing. You will be a what? You will be a blessing. First of all, you will be a blessing. To yourself, to your generation. You will not be a cost to your generation." God says you will be a blessing to your what? Generation. The blessing that was going to extend even to you and I, God says Abraham will be the foundation and the root of that blessing. If only he could do what they wish to actually be, and that is totally yielded to God. So he submitted to God, and then the things began to flow. And so when that happened, God caused that quarrel between him and Lot. Now, this is the contentment, the power of contentment. First, the solution to separate came from who? Abraham. Praise the Lord. Why? Abraham valued human persons to property, to possessions, to land, to things. So his relationship with Lot mattered a lot for him because Lot was a human person. The value he attached to material things was less than the value he attached to human world relationship. Many of us, because of business, because of money, because of things we hope to get, have solid relationships with people. You cheat and cheat and cheat and cheat yourself. You cheat and cheat and cheat and cheat your brother. You cheat and cheat and cheat to the point that you have to sacrifice your brother in order to do what? Make money. That is what is happening in our world today, even among Christians. We cheat because of position, because I am still probably to be the bishop. Every priest that crosses my way, I will damage his day before authorities. This is what is happening. That's why in your business places and workplaces, you see the spirit of God in God. You know, the God is having a God to eat God. But somehow, the God will do what? Go after the very words. God, because he has interest. But here, because Abraham was contented, they look at the lost place and say, "Choose. Choose the blessings. Wherever you choose, you will go. And then, if you choose left, you go left. And then I will go what? Right. If you go right, I will no words left. Remember, he was carrying a blessing upon his head. And instead of saying, since God promised me, I will choose to go, he was contented. And so he said, choose. And the man chose. And when he chose, then he went to verse 14, he says, let God let me and open his eyes. Amen. Amen. Lot was a religious man, but he was a carnal religious person. Lot, that name Lot means veil, something covering his eyes. So when he was choosing, he looked at the environment with a carnal eye. Some of you have gone into businesses, into contracts with the carnal eye. You saw me and you feel like this situation, if I get into this, it is going to be wonderful. And only for you to realize that when you get into this, it is a total world mess. You see yourself crashing and your business crashing, and at the end of the day, you come back crying. That was what happened to Lot. He chose, yes, he was Abraham's brother and ability, but what he chose was the wrong choice. And that wrong choice led him, because the word of God says that was before God destroyed Sodom and Lot, the world. And the side he chose led him into the community of people who were sinners and who were wicked. Amen. Amen. You remember, God called Abraham from all because of sin, because of idol worship, because of wickedness. He said, leave that place to a land I will show you. And then God showed him a different land. Now, his brother was choosing a similar kind of environment. And when he went there, he met obstacles, he met difficulties. But then, friends, in our life, in our journey, we must be contented. When Abraham finally made his choice, God said to him, God opened his hand and God said, look, and he looked, and he could not see the end. My dear brother, you will not see the end of your blessing. You will discover that the end of your blessing is endless. The source of your blessing will flow in such a manner that you discover that it is endless. That's the kind of blessing that God wants to give to each and every one of us. But first, we must find human peace beyond what we think that we can get. Now, somebody, a man, a business idea will say something in the presence of Thomas Watson. Thomas Watson is the founder of IBM. IBM is International Business Machine Corporation. He calls a meeting, and in that meeting, the people gather, different managers of the organization gather, and then they sit around the table, there are heaps of papers. And what were these heaps of papers? Problems of the company that was taking the company to go down. And then they look at the papers, and then they also provide solutions to those problems. And so when he walked in, being the owner of the company and the CEO of that company, they were in a meeting and they talked for hours. And the boy, he got up from the seat, looked at the papers that were pushed before him, and then he looked at those papers. After looking at those papers, he ran his hand through the papers. He uses that to shuffle the papers, and all of a sudden, he lifted the papers and threw them in the hall where they were having the meeting. And every part of the hall was covered with papers. And people were wondering, why is he doing this? You can imagine him having a piece of papers, and I show the whole of the church will be filled with what? Papers. Everywhere, white papers. And I said, what is for that mean? Why should he act like that? Then when the whole place was calm, he stood up to them and he said, that there is no problem in this company, but the only problem in this company is with all of you. And he says, because nobody pays particular attention to one another, to customers. You do not pay enough attention to customers. That's why the company is running into problem. Child of God, I tell you this. Some of you are having problems with your company because you don't pay enough attention to your customers, enough attention to your business, to know the details of your business, to know where your business is having a problem, where there is a hitch in your problem, because sometimes your mind is fixed somewhere else instead of fixing somewhere else. Sometimes when we pray and pray, sometimes God gives you an idea of how your business will progress. Do you pay particular attention to your customers? What is your relationship with your customers? That's the thing. When people come to your shop, how do they feel? Do they feel good or do they feel happy? Understand? They feel happy. Then I saw people that come to their shop and will never come again. They go in 5,000 and I offer them for working. Your customers tomorrow will not come to your shop again. I will not know how you treat people. Sometimes you find the money more than a human person. Welcome. Sit down. There are some people who go to your shop, they must give you seats. Praise the Lord. Yeah, that's a dream. When once you get to your shop, you go that they are arrogant, even in knowledge. When once you go there, and I welcome, they will bring seats and give you. The next thing is your family.
But remember, today, if you have never known, the Lord said, as you said,
in the church. That is the ministry that God has called you to. And that is where your salvation lies. If you understand that you are in business as ministry, you will not always think first of cheating people. You will think of serving. That is why you will find your customer. So when you are looking at a particular area of business you want to do, and what the other person is doing, is that your call? Is that your place of call? Did they call you to be a minister of shoe selling? Did God call you to be a minister of shoe selling? Is your ministry in clothes selling? Is your ministry in fabricating clothes? Is your ministry in iron tools or oil tools? Is your ministry in rock selling, building material selling? Is that your ministry? If that is your ministry that God has called you to, child of God, you will succeed in it. If your ministry is in clothes selling, in that clothes business, you will climb the return. If your ministry is in shoe selling, in that ministry, God will raise a place of work, growth for you. So do not look down on the particular ministry that God has given to you, but realize that, first of all, it's a ministry, it's a call. I might not be a good businessman, and I might not be. But my brethren, don't jealous that man or woman where he or she is. The first question you should ask yourself each day is that a ministry? Is it where God wants to bless me from? Abraham moved over to Egypt, and God turned back on him and was looking at him until he came back to where God wanted him to be. Are you joining your friend because you see the blessing is going there? No, that is not a place of God. Your place of in that small business you have kept somewhere, then God will promote you and you will grow higher and higher and higher and higher in the name of Jesus. And so, my friends, we must be contented. Do not just look at how green it is in that area, because in that place you might not learn, you might not discover what exactly He wants you to do. Again, one other thing that you must also have in mind that Abraham did when he was making this choice with his brother, he also realized Abraham rested in God's provision. Amen. Amen. Rest that God provides. God was his brother. Now, Lot chose the path that he chose. Abraham was left practically with nothing, because he had chosen the better path. So what was there for Abraham was a leftover. But what did God do? The one was as soon as Lot left, God appeared and said to him, "Look up." And when he looked up, God said, "That is what I will give to your descendants." And then he followed. At this point, my dear brothers and sisters, Abraham yielded. Everybody say yielded. I know you know what it means to yield, to surrender. Because now, Abraham has totally submitted to God. Lot is no more there. No relative is with him again. He has left the father's house, and he has left the company. He is where God wants it to be. And this one I pray for you that in your any place of ministry, God will bless you from there. God will bless you from there. God will repeat the same promise to Abraham to you, which is the name of Jesus. And now your ministry business will become a place of pray for you in the name of Jesus. And that's why anybody that is standing up against you will not succeed in the name of Jesus. Now, this is what happened again during the crucifixion. In place of a blessing for somebody here, as soon as the blessing drops, something like a cloth fell to come. They did something like, no, not a cloth. Praise the Lord. God asked you, what I need to do. Have you got Shia before? Eh? And if you go to buy Shia, there's nothing that. Is it foil that they call it? That they use in marketing. They use it to do foil. I put on rice. Something like a foil came to cover on the ground where a blessing had been prepared for God. Something like a blessing is fire. And when it happened that way, that thing came to cover it. Something happened. The Bible from the sea fell down to that position. Amen. So our source of blessing is in the Word of God. Contentment with the Word of God. I want you to stand up. Everybody that has a Bible here, if you believe me, you don't have a Bible, please connect me. Lift up your Bible. Even if you don't have a Bible, connect with somebody that has one. In the spirit. And at that instant also a word was given by God, and that word is from Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 13, and it says, you shall no longer be tame, but you shall be what? Head. As we read all this Bible, Father, we believe in your word. Your word is life. Your word gives me, your word brings deliverance. As we speak this word unto the life of your sons and daughters this morning, may the blessings contained in it be ours in the name of Jesus. Father, we also decree and prophetically pronounce that your children in their businesses and in their offices will no longer be failing, but they will be succeeding in the name of Jesus. Through our commitment to your word and believe and trust in your word, Lord, you will bring about upliftment and the release of our blessings in the name of Jesus. Every covering and over and the blessings that you have released for your children, may your word be implanted in our lives to bring about the release and progress in our lives in the name of Jesus. Walk over our heads in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us sit. And so, there is that aspect that we must believe and trust in the provision of God. God provided a replacement for Abraham when his brother chose the better, the city. God opened his eyes to see that the better part lies with God. That's why God gave Jesus for you and I. God did not, Abraham did not just believe in a land. Get this, in the secret. Abraham did not just believe in a land. In fact, what he had is not a land, but what he had was a person. And that person is Jesus Christ. That's what the word of God says. I see him in the distant past. A root I see. Abraham saw that root. He saw it far and he believed in it. That's why when he was released by God, his blessing came. Child of God, you must believe not in the land, not in the property, not in the money, not in the things you see, but believe in the one who has all of them. And that is Jesus. That's why God gave him up for you and I to die. So that when we ever be focused on him, when we ever be yield to him, when we ever be trust in him, our breakthrough will come. Abraham's breakthrough came through faith. That's why the word of God says, that it is not by science or by might, but by what? Faith. And that is why he is called the father of what? Nations. Our father in faith. He believed God. If you look at the land that was physically before him, he did not want it. But what he saw was greater than what Lot saw. Because God came, opened his eyes, and he saw, and he believed. As you believe in God today, God will release your blessing in the name of Jesus. Amen. I tell you another thing that happened during the rosary, and we will pray that God will release all of them for us today in the name of Jesus. There is someone that you bought the land, and as soon as you bought that land, it was in your community. I don't know if there's anybody that wanted to buy another land, already bought, you will buy it in the name of Jesus. But when the land was bought, some people from your community ganged up against you, trying to prevent you from possessing the land. But they will not stop you. Or in your business, is there any business venture you want to get into that is going to give you upliftment and promotion? And maybe some persons are conspiring against you. That I see. Spirit of conspiracy against some persons. We ask the Lord this morning that they will scatter the garment of the enemy against you in the name of Jesus. Because the Lord says they will come from one direction, but they will scatter the world seven directions. And so anybody here that there is something good coming to you, and somebody is there, or some persons are gathering against you, may those who gather against you be thrown into confusion in the name of Jesus. You shall succeed through that plot that God has positioned you to possess, so that your deliverance and your progress and success will explode in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 And then they three down those the Lord will give another one. This one is a woman. You have carried a baby. That woman had to walk away from this side. This girl was carrying a young baby. And she was crying. I don't know what was making her cry. But I pray that if there's anything in this city that will put you to shame and disgrace, that God will cancel it in the name of Jesus. Anything that will make you to cry and cry, that is not the design of God, that through the sacrifice of this mass, and through the sacrifice of this program, and through the fact that we invited our blessed mother, who is the mother of love and the mother of care, that condition of pain and sorrow will be removed from you in the name of Jesus. The Lord will bring about releasement in the name of Jesus. There is another one, the Lord also revealed a conspiracy against a young woman. Some of your circle of friends, they like you, you share things with them. Everything you tell them, you discuss your matters as friends. But they are planning something against you to set you up. I don't know who wants to set anybody up. But when the Lord will release him, the essence is that he will make you to succeed. They will not succeed over you. In your business, they will not succeed. In whatever you are doing, they will not succeed. Every plan of the enemy against you will not succeed. Because of the fact that God has said, I will bless you. And because you are yielding, God will bless you. My dear friends, when we yield to God, when we follow God's instruction, He changes and fights our battle. He changes and fights our battle. Talk with me to Genesis 25. You meet Jacob. Jacob, God had pronounced and said in time past that Jacob will be a ruler. Though he's the younger, but he will rule over his brother. His brother Esau was the first who came out from the womb. But he said, God pronounced in that text of scripture that he would be a ruler. And when he was gone, the problem started. When God has made a pronouncement on your head, it will stand. It will do what? It will stand. It doesn't matter who stands against it. That pronouncement will stand. Remember what I told you this morning? God said, I should tell you that your business case is your ministry. From that ministry that God has given to so many of us from birth, from there we shall You might have struggled in that business. You might have struggled in that thing and you feel that I'm not making it good here. Child of God, I tell you and I announce to you this morning that that place of announcement is for you. It is from there that you will be announced. It is from there you will be recognized. It is from there you will be promoted. Because God has said it, that that is your place of growth. So shall it be in the name of Jesus. Jacob started to fight. Even though there was a point he had to cheat his brother, he was trying to grow, move faster than God. He was not working in accordance with the divine plan of God for him. He was working by his own strength. That's why his name was called. He was a cheat. He was a supplant. He wanted to supplant his brother. He did, but because at that point he was working with his carnal self like lost, what did he do? He made a mistake. And that led him to be a fugitive, a refugee for 20 days. Amen. But because there was an anointing, there was an unction of a ministry of progress and growth upon him, that's why anywhere he went, even though he was a chief, he was progressing. Amen. Can you light the lamp and cover it? Can you light the candle and cover it not to shine? You can only cover it for a while. At a point, it will find a way and it will do what? Explode. But there was something holding Jacob back. Jacob wanted to take it by force. He believed that it is by force and strength that he would take it. See, you cannot do more than you can do except God is waiting for you. And that's why God is calling each and every one of us. Submit to him. Seek me. Jesus says, seek you first the kingdom of God and his work, righteousness. And what? I want to hear you tell this church. And what? Every what? Every other thing will follow. Now, ask yourself a question. Have I sought God? And where are you seeking God? Some people are seeking God with their own strengths. Some people are seeking God in their own places. Some people are going to native doctors that their business will move. You know better. You're in the market. There is competition in the market also. You go to shop. Every day you sit down. The other shop, people are grouping in and grouping out, grouping in and grouping out, grouping out. You wonder, what is it? Why is it my own not moving? Probably they taste your own, they probably your own. God will lose that your own today in the name of Jesus. And sometimes these people you see that have gone somewhere to sell markets, to move everybody in their market, people are flocking and flocking. After a while, this lasts. Did they happen? Huh? The next day when you come, you saw that the shop is closed. And people will be there. What about this man? They say he has a little ticket. So we are getting on that. Oh my God, when you're going to the business, not the other alone. And your own will arise. Your ministry will grow. Your business ministry will grow. Your work ministry will grow. And God will for you in the name of Jesus. And so Jacob did everything within his own power. But my dear friends, in chapter 31, the Lord came to him, precisely verse 3, the Lord came to him and said, arise, go back to your family, to your relatives, and to your people. And I speak that word to somebody today. I don't know where you are right now in your business ministry. Probably you've been at the lowest end of your business ministry. God is speaking to you this morning that you should arise. That you will arise. That chain of backwardness will break. I want to make this our sister as a point of contact for us this morning that chain of backwardness will break. That chain that is holding you back will break. to you, I'm giving to you to go in the name of Jesus. Whatever belongs to you, that man has kept part, that man will lose it in the name of Jesus. God will appear in the spirit and bring about your liberation in the name of Jesus. There will be a turnaround in your destiny and in your ministry, your business ministry in the name of Jesus. There will be a point of unleashment for you in the name of Jesus. There will be a point of growth for you in the name of Jesus. There will be an explosion for you in the name of Jesus. People will see you and they will wonder how it happened in the name of Jesus. God said, the hour has come for me to bless you. The hour has come for you to be liberated from that place of stagnation. You will no longer be a slave or runner. You shall be a leader. You shall be a leader in your business. Your business then will begin to shine. And on the way, he was afraid of his brother Esau. And so he got to their point. He demanded whatever belongs to him, into two groups, two camps. He sent them ahead. Go so that my brother, when he sees you, he will accept. And his brother, seeing them, was happy. He said, "Where is my brother?" He said he went for his brother and he met his brother. And in fact, he embraced him. Why? The hour of God's blessing has come for Jacob. Jacob was no longer to be a runner. He was no longer to be a man in exile, a fugitive, because the hour that God has decided to bless him has what? Has come. But then, that's my prayer for you this morning, that your hour of liberation and celebration has come in the name of Jesus. But now, see the high point of it. In chapter 32, when he had done that, he slept. And when he woke up, he met the man of God. He met the angel of God, and both of them were forced. They fought and fought until the morning sun came. Nobody was waiting, neither the angel of himself. And then when the angel saw that it was morning, he cried out. Let me go. And Jacob said, "Sir, is anybody standing with you? I'm coming. Can you give your hand at the back of me? Is anybody there? Nobody." The angel said to him, "Can you let me go?" And he said, "I will never let you go unless you do what? I will never let you go unless you do what? I will never let you go unless you do what?" Can you tell Jesus that you will never let him go unless he blesses you? But we're not letting God rest until he settles our case. Many of you have been crying. Jesus, I beg you this morning, look at your sons and brothers crying. Some are making efforts. But it says they are not making efforts. Something is holding them back. So the angel broke his heel. Wicked. Okay. Amen. He was no longer complete. He gave up something to get something. Child of God, you want to give up something to get something. Can I see his hands? with the Holy Ghost. Wherever the spiritual conflicts are coming from, let it be destroyed in the spirit in the name of Jesus. Because when we invoke the name of the Lord, let the defense be affected in the name of Jesus. Because you stand on this ground constantly to deal with him. And as you step out from here this morning into your shop, any degree of authority and power in your place of ministry, your place of ministry is supposed to be a place of favor for you. May the favor from the house of God for you.
Thank you.